Good evening, at least for some of us here in the Middle East. It's 8 p.m. So good evening, everybody. This is F1, New Theoretical Contributions to Peace Science. My name is Arie Kacowicz, and you know me by now. So Galia, Press-Barnathan, your official host in this conference, is with me as a co-chair and co-discussant. And we have five presenters. So I really encourage you to stick to the 10 minutes that we are suggesting, because we want to offer comments and we want to have a discussion, right? And we have to end on time because I have another South American with Brazilians, Raquel, after that at the 10 p.m. So let me introduce very briefly our presenters in the panel. So we will start with Rami, Georg, Johann. He has a very interesting story, moving from Iraq to Germany. I quote him, born in the war, grew up in the war and fled to Germany because of the consequences of the war. He has a PhD at the University of Vechta, Germany. His interest in peace science methodology, peaceful change, world order, empire formation. And he will, we didn't get a paper, but we will listen to his very interesting presentation on a theory formation of an empire in the 21st century. The second paper is by Raquel dos Santos Missagia from the Fluminense Federal University in Brazil. Is that in Rio, Raquel? Rio de Janeiro?
Yes.
Okay. I live in. Mm-hmm. So you are Carioca. You are a doctoral student at the postgraduate program in strategic studies in defense and security, researcher at the space security subgroup at the Simulation Science Laboratory at the Naval War College in Brazil. And Raquel will share with us her work in progress about theoretical elements for decision-making analysis. Apologies. The third paper is by Professor Reşat Bayer. We are all here in this virtual room because of him, because he's pretty much related to the Peace Science Association. Reşat, I'm looking at my notes, he's an associate professor of international relations at Kacowicz University. Interested in peaceful change in different types of peace. And he will be presenting a paper discussing nature powers and peaceful change. If you were in the plenarium, in the plenary session, you got the trailer, right, for the movie. Professor Manas, if I pronounce that correctly, would be Chatterji. I apologize for the pronunciation. He's a senior professor of management at Binghamton University in the United States, and an adjunct professor in economics and the Asian and Asian American Studies program. He has about 30 books and 80 scholarly articles in the areas of peace science, disarmament, economic cooperation, conflict management, regional science and technology. He also sent us a very elaborate PowerPoint about the potentialities of peace science and regional science in disaster management, with special reference to COVID. And the challenge for you would be to get 26 slides in 10 minutes, because we want to be authoritarian on that. And last but not least, we have a Professor T.V. Paul from McGill University. I didn't mention that before, former president of ISA and the creator of this network of peaceful change. Also, TB has a large number of books and articles, And TV will be talking about realism, liberalism, regional orders in East Asia towards a hybrid approach. And it's not the hybrid of the Zoom area, it's a different hybrid. Okay, so, and of course, last but not least, we have Galia Press-Barnathan, my friend and colleague, the director of the Davis Institute and associate professor in the Department of International Relations, with a wide range of interests, IR theory, popular culture, political economy of peace transitions. And she will be the main discussant, and probably after Galia's comments, I will not have much to add. Okay, so without further ado, the virtual floor goes to Rami. In the Q&A, you can use chat, especially for Rami, and I think that Larissa, that you are there behind the name, a former German student of mine at Rothberg might help us maybe in the kind of translation between English and German back and forth, if there are questions for Rami. So Rami, you can share your presentation and tell us about world orders and empire formation. Yes.
Tell me. Starting now, I will read and later I share my
bullshit. Okay.
Okay. The zone of research, starting point of my theory, of the idea of this theory, there are many reasons to question the world order, starting from the transition of the 20th century into 21st century. If you were born in war and grew up in war, and had to flee because of the wars, you ask yourself, why is there no total peace in our world system? No long-term securing of peace, human rights, democratic values. The starting point of this theory was the instability of the world order and the changed role of the USA as invaluable world power and world police, and another democratic state. Goals of formation and empire in this theory, providing a cognitive interpretation slide, events and manifestation of the world, research questions as seen in the long term as analytical questions on the producial dimension of the world order of the 21st century. Changes and challenges in the world as necessary for the formation and empire. Core idea of this theory have 2 points, unrivaled and fusion. My thesis, the fusion eliminates the competition between states, nation, cultures, and peoples. Missionary work, human rights and democratic values, and constitutional patriotism can play here an important role. The meaning of power, I mean here economic power and the military power, play an important role too. Basic questions, research questions here in this thesis, which state joined the Western Empire? I have 5 models in this theory, and the ideal models is the 5th models. If I say which state joined the Western Empire in the 5th concept at the beginning, I mean here the Western Empire, the name, I don't mean only the Western cultures or only the Western states. I mean the idea, the Western states after the Second World War, the idea of the European Union. The second question, the first question is, which alternative models are possible and implementable in the theory, the concept one to fourth concepts? You can, if we have 100 concepts, we have the same result. I want more to show as model what is the difference between this concept, between this models. The third questions, research questions, how can these alternative models to be assessed? The answer of these questions justifies the selection and conception of the Western Empire in the fifth concept. The last question, research question is, how can the Western Empire be implemented in the fifth concept? 20 cents of modeling, according to Hans Morgenthau and Carl Vidoj, the meaning of constitutional partitism. Common alignment of values, according to Hans Morgenthau, as a moral and political community. We produce this weak community. And I tried Hans Morgenthau with his theory, with his model of direct opposition and pattern of competition. So here is for the checking the stability or instability in the models from the first model to first models. Carl Vidoj play here a very important point with his political cybernetic, the nation building and development process. We need here, if we have a new state, we need here, or a new empire, we need the time span and the integration process to produce the political loyalty. The importance of constitutional patriotism for finding identity and the need for community of values. What is the fusion here? Voluntary readiness and acceptance the imperial order. This is a very important point, to acceptance the imperial order. We know after the Second World War, this was where necessary to formation the Europe, the idea for Europe Union. On this point, to accept the new imperial order. This is the same idea with the Western Empire. We have now many crises in our world order. Well, this is the necessary point to acceptance the new imperial order.
Security. Do you want, Rami? Sorry. Do you want to share this to show us that in the slides that you send us, the PowerPoint? Because you have about 4 minutes left.
I can continue.
No, but if you want to share, if you want to show us your PowerPoint, so we can.
Later. Later. Now I want to continue, please. Yeah. Okay. Later, I show. Security and stability through the fusion. I talk about the fusion implements the competition between states and nation and cultures. Another point here is the imperial cycle. Within these five models, the Western Empire of the fifth concept has the chance to flow the imperial cycle like Morgenthau has described, and surviving in the long term. Transfer of Morgenthau's remarks to the evolution of the fifth first models, instable hunger for power in the international relation, sustained in the national certification of power in the anarchic international system, there are no structural limits. There are therefore only three ideal types of politics, maintaining power, increasing power, and demonstrating power. Very important to differentiate the fusion only refers the Western Empire. The dissolution of the state and great powers within words and concepts.
Okay.
Justified with historical and correct literature with regard to the relation between the state and the prognosis for
Rami, I'm sorry. I have to stop you. It's now 10 minutes, and we have to, you know, be fair to all the five presenters. So if you want to share your screen to show us the last part of the model, because, you know, we have to really stick to 10 minutes to allow for discussion, and there are five of you. Okay, so please share the screen and show us the model. Try to summarize in 3 minutes, please.
Show the models.
I'm sorry, I'm
no problem. No problem. I have no one. I have no, only one slide to later. No problem. This is the first concept in the theory. I tried to reflect the our world order today to reflect, and this is the second concept here with four word system, and the third. This is the fourth concept. Well, this is the fifth concept in this theory. And I have only one slide to read, or I have only this slide. but Arie.
Yes.
The time is finished?
No, take 2 more minutes because you still have more. I mean,
okay. I'll show you now not only this my models, yeah, and this thesis, yeah? And I tried now to finish my slide here. Why is necessary to formation a new empire in our 21st century? We have many points here, like the. Like the loss of legitimacy in the democratic system. We have increasing power in the authoritarian systems, no democratic states, non-democratic states. A very important point here, this regional powers as a challenge of our global democratic, of our well, this is danger for the global place, like Turkey, like Iran, now Pakistan, and Indian. The problems between this. And another very important point, post-historical imperial space provoke most post-imperial dreams, like Russia today. Have this dream in Caucasus or in the post Soviet place, or the Turkey, like the Osmani Empire. This is the dream, or the to the Islamic organization, have the same dream. This is very important point of this. I am sorry about my language. I hope you understand.
That's fine, Rami. That's perfect.
I have multiple sclerosis. I don't know. You know this. I have problem to speak. I have today feel for our to speak. I don't feel my face, and I tried to speak and yeah.
So your effort is remarkable, and we could understand what you said. Thank you very much, and I apologize that you know I'm have to be rude, because we will come back to you with comments. Okay, yeah. So if you can stop the share the screen, if you can stop the. So the next speaker will be Raquel dos Santos Missagia, and Raquel will be talking about theoretical elements for a decision making analysis. Okay, Raquel, your floor is yours. Try to stick to 10 minutes. You sent me a relatively short paper, right? So it's doable.
Thank you. Are you listening?
Yes.
Okay, let's start. Hi. This work seeks to present an analysis of new realist and new Marxist theories from a semi-peripheral perspective, in this case, from Brazil. This means thinking these theories from the concepts of autonomy and development within the international system. And this, it's not really new, because some Brazilian and Argentine authors have done this. Even considering that Waltz tells us little about the influence of economic aspects and how these aspects influence the same periphery of the international system, we believe that a certain set of studies that were conducted between 1960s and 1970s and that were known as the dependence theories can help us to understand an important aspect that are the strategies that countries localized in the semi-periphery of the system to achieve development and autonomy. The international relations understood from non-central areas of the international system should consider that these regions have strategies to ensure
that— How many people are listening?
Yes. that these regions have strategies to ensure that survival in international system. In that sense, when we look at the structure of the international system as defined by Waltz and even Wallenstein, although they have a ontological difference, we know that inequality of capability is a key element of economic and political dynamics. In this frame, it is necessary to consider a fundamental aspect to understand international relations from the non-central areas of international politics. Mainly, the relationship between the foundations of politics, its specific practice and economic development. In Latin America, this perspective of analysis initially took shape from studies on the conditioning factors of dependence and underdevelopment. These research gave rise to the set of theories of dependence. Theories of dependence in their different hues are a decisive paradigm for the analyze and peripheral and world capitalism. They contribute to remaking the uniqueness of the world economy by breaking with the time cuts made by developmentalism that saw underdevelopment as a delay. Within this perspective, Fernando Henrique Cardoso formulated a relevant approach to think about dependence. Cardoso and Faleto in 1970 starts from Cipau's thesis and establish the analysis of dependence, establishing something closer to an ideal type of dependence. Independence and Development in Latin America, the book says, the fundamental theoretical problem consists of determination of the models that adopt the structures of domination, because it is through it that one understands the dynamics of class relations. In this sense, Cardoso and Faleto are interested in understanding the dynamics of dependent societies and how it creates and restricts possibilities of insertion in the world economy. It is from the articulation between the development patterns of Latin American societies, with the dependence that these authors affirm that national politics might should have autonomy, but they experience a situation of domination in which it is necessary to choose between development, dependence, or stagnating, or autonomy. For these authors, it is necessary, therefore, to define a perspective of interpretation that highlights the structural links between the development situation and the hegemonic centers of central economies, but that does not attribute to the latter the full determination of the dynamics of development. This was one of the relevant aspects of this approach, as it demonstrated how internal and external factors were combined. Despite political autonomy, economic dependence is a conditioning factor that is presented in national productive structure that revolves around the foreign market. Dependence, it really involves a great inequality between the economic, which creates a productive structure market by dependent structure characteristics and bonds, and the politician whose breath the action does not allow him to act on this structure and dynamic bonds of dependence and replace them with others without probably failing into stalling, irrationalism, or adventure. It is the distinctive character of the economic factor concerning the policy that makes Cardoso and Faleto affirm that a national society can have a certain autonomy of decisions without the productive system, and forms of income distribution allow it to equate with developed central countries, not even some peripheral countries in the process of development. This singular characteristic of certain areas in which they have some political and economic capacity without, however, being at the same level of the center or periphery was better understood within that perspective of the world system, the Wallenstein. The concepts of semi-periphery, a contribution of Immanuel Wallenstein, help us to characterize the space of possibilities and restrictions that semi-peripheral countries face in their search for survival from a perspective of productive force. For this author, the international system is defined as a modern world system, he affirmed. A world system is a social system, a system that has limits, structures, groups, members, rules of legitimation, and coerence. His life results from the conflicting forces that hold him together by tension and fragment him as each of the groups eternally seek to reshape it for their benefit. The world system relies on a world economy that operates at the heart of an arena larger than any political entity can fully control, going beyond the nation state, forming central, semi-peripheral, and peripheral areas. The structure of the modern world system for Wallenstein is identified with the international division of labor, with the balance of power, and the search for survival in interstate competition. Dougherty and Faltzgraf affirmed Wallenstein analysis is essentially neo-Marxist, but it combines realist elements with Marxism, sharing with realists such as Kenneth Walls and Hadley Bull the idea that the international system is characterized by anarchy, the absence of singular global political authority. I come to the end of the presentation because I think that a short minute to end. My conclusion, a point is to that based on the classic works of international relations, this work sought to bring some theoretical elements to a systemic understanding of foreign policy analysis, understand the interaction dynamics of the same periphery in the international system through the search for autonomy and scientific and technological development reveals the importance of the variable knowledge as an important systemic element in foreign policy analysis. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Raquel, for sticking to the time framework. So our next speaker will be Reşat Bayer from Koç University, discussing major powers and peaceful change in an era of global upheaval. Reşat, please.
Okay, I assume you can see my screen again. Yes, great, thank you. So yes, I am interested somewhat in major powers, but I'm interested in sort of thinking about both of them together, so major powers and minor powers. Here I will go a little bit fast over this material in interest of time. So yes, we are used to thinking about the sort of gradations of peace, and there is a long scholarship on this. It's still ongoing, a continuation of scholarship, and many, many others today, and as well as on the panel who have worked on these topics. We are interested in these ideas of, you know, these sort of categories of peace, if you want, thinking about how they can be formulated by considering varieties of things such as the degrees of acceptance of the other, degrees of interactions with each other, as well as resolving incompatibilities. These are things, you know, this is a sort of a one line of research that I sometimes work on, then I come back on, and that I've worked on at different stages in the last years, basically. So what I'm interested in today's part is trying to contribute to this sort of contrary conversation about the attainment of, if let's call this, higher peace levels, the sort of gradations of peace, higher attaining gradations of peace. And specifically, my interest is with those that we consider as minor powers. I should say that minor powers here, I don't differentiate between, let's call them, middle powers and the rest. I'm taking if you're not a major power, you're a minor power sort of an approach here, in the interest of simplifications. One could make, I suppose, further qualifications here. Now, when we look at the sort of the literature that has come about over the decades on this, I mean, lots of the explanations that we offer for the minor powers are rather similar to those that we offer for major powers. So when we think about discussions about territorial peace, if you resolve your territorial differences, then you should be at a higher gradation of peace. Those are ideas that have been around for a rather long time now. And if you do, whether you think of them as norms or institutions, whatever, that, you know, there's some of these features that we bring out, such as territory or domestic political regime, role of trade, etc., they can be applied for different sort of entities at different levels. But yet we also should know that the dynamics of peaceful relations for those that are minor powers, we might expect that they will be different for those that are major powers. This could be about both the status that the major powers have, the rights, the responsibilities, the position that they occupy in the international system, their roles in IGOs, etc. It's just, there's a sort of a different feeling and different sort of, not only capacity, but that capacity brings a lot of other things to major powers as well. And this then leads me to considering the sort of the role of major powers and minor powers peace discussions, if you want. So if we are going to have higher levels of minor power peace gradations, higher levels of these relations, if you want, what can major powers do or not do, if you want? So two things that I really focus on in the study is one as the sort of major powers as the setters of the tone. And this we can think about as in the longer literature about, you know, Wallenstein's discussions about particularism, universalism, that bring to us discussions of accord and discord, which resonate in today's items as well, of rules of the game. Are they agreed upon? Are they not agreed upon? how much do the major powers agree? But this also has implications for minor powers. I mean, do minor powers find it easier to work with each other, to cooperate with each other in an era of universalism versus an era of particularism? Some of the discussions of Wallenstein were more inclined to be about that this was peaceful relations, but it was much more focused on the major power discussion in the most part. But yet we can maybe think about how if major powers are setting the tones, then this should have implications for the minor powers as well in how they are able to conduct themselves and at what opportunities there are for them to bargain more easily with each other, to make concessions from what is created by these, if you want, the rules of the game being much clearer. But that's, of course, one thing that is maybe more elusive, the sort of the setters of the tone, the rules of the game. And the other discussion that we can have is directly about bringing major powers as allies into this discussion. And this is, of course, literature that brings in into the Middle East discussions, the role of the US, the roles of Soviets in different parts of the world and in previous eras. In today's era, we can bring in again how China is brought in into Korea conversations. But all of this then is suggesting to us that besides the sort of thinking about major powers as setters of the tone and so on, then we also have them as the sort of allies managing each other, controlling each other, trying to avoid, if you want, some sort of crisis emerging, which could bring them into some sort of bigger conflict. So we know that whether it's the alliance abandonment entrapment dilemmas, how they might be materializing in these discussions. So then major powers, then a second line from the literature that we can bring in has to do more with what they can bring into the ground as potential allies. Yet in a wider sense, what we are thinking about when we consider what major powers are is a sort of interesting statement a long time ago from the ending from Gilpin's book, basically on the best one can hope for about major powers is that in their self-interest, they will cooperate to fashion a more stable and humane international political and economic order, which then should maybe carry on, perhaps is the implication, to others' relations, to how withdrawals from certain regions can be really problematic, and then sometimes crediting, you know, a given president or whether a major country, major power with increasing the chances of maybe talks taking place and so on, regardless of whether that results in some real big peace change attainment or not. So lots of different things coming to us from varieties of both academic as well as policy discussions. And in one sense, the literature gives us a lot of different things as to what we can expect major powers. We see them as discussed in languages of their interested parties, to how they can balance one of the entities versus the others, to how they can be guarantors, and so on, that they address security dilemma relations, that in the mediation literature, we hear language about ripening conflict or delivering stuff. Again, tons of things about what major powers can, if you want, deliver and bring to the sides that are at conflict with each other, to then, of course, the reverse of this discussion where it's how they are part of the problem, you know, labeling countries as rogue states, their own internal competitions with each other, supremacy, and so on, their own domestic issues with public opinion and so on, how this also comes to influence the relations with others. So what this then comes to me then is that when we are thinking about gradations of peace, we can have expectations that major powers really are always playing a positive role, to always playing a very negative role, to that it's very uneven. And some of the previous literature that has come out, Benjamin Miller, among others, of course, has also contributed to this sort of discussions, that it's very uneven if what we can expect from outside external major powers. And that's also something that Galia was presenting in the presentation earlier today. So I did some statistical analysis about this from based on a data set of levels of peace. I looked at sort of former belligerents, time until transition to higher level of peace. I'm just going to show time until higher level of peace. I'm not going to bring in the war dimension here. If you're interested, I can talk to you about what I find there. Broadly, here are some of the main findings that emerge from this sort of statistical analysis that, of course, has to be then built upon and examined further with other sorts of research analyses. One is that major power discourse, so it is sort of universalism, particularism does not come out to be statistically significant in any model. So the idea that the rules of the game being clarified among major powers, improving, not improving, having any sort of a statistically significant effect on minor power relations does not materialize. So if there is something about universalism, particularism, it seems to be much more directed towards major powers themselves and doesn't seem to be coming and experienced with the rest of the international system, if you want. On the other hand, a minor power alliances with a major power does statistically significantly have emerged to have a relationship, but again, it's rather indirect. So in the one sense, it is over time that we find it, so it's not a direct effect, but only over time that we find a departure from the lowest level of peace to a one category higher, if you want. On the other hand, for medium to higher level of peace, if you want, I'll show you a table which what I mean by this. There is something that emerges there, but it's really a post-World War II effect, basically, and particularly a post-World War II effect of Europe, whether it is about Germany or Italy, and how during that very special era with some of their allies, they were able to increase their sort of improvements of relations. And in East Europe, we find something similar as well. Again, these are some of the tables that that basically are talking about what I just found here. I also did some analysis with an alternative data set to show that it's not just driven by one data set type, but I have a completely different piece levels analysis here. This is the Paul, the Gert Steele data set, and a very different alliance data set. Again, a similar thing is coming out, that there's something going on with alliances and higher levels of peace, that it is statistically, at least there's a correlation here that maybe requires a little bit more examination, if you want. What does this leave us with in interest of time? At the end, the key thing about peace is that it's about you have conflicting parties. That is the main item. Yes, third parties in various forms, major powers, etc., have a role to play. But of course, it is about conflicting parties. At the same time, however, I also do not want to make this to be that the major powers have nothing to do or no play or role to do. Of course, within the UN Security Council system and others, we have to think about their not only the sort of privileges that they have, but also the duties and responsibilities. And leaving that discussion out entirely is also problematic, saying that it's only a Middle Eastern problem, an African problem, that Africans have to solve their own problems. Of course, that's the case, but that should not mean a get out of jail card for the major powers and their sort of, if you want, responsibilities that they have in, as well to the system. And again, all of this then is suggesting that, yes, there is something that major powers can do, but it is not going to come out from, if you want, the sort of wider normative features, at least in the sort of measurements that I've seen and used here. It has to require other analyses, other sorts of dynamics being brought here. And again, I think there are lots of things that tells us about quality of peace and peaceful change that we can do in different sorts of research orientations as well for future thinking. Anyway, let me stop here and I look forward to the Q&A. Bye-bye. Let me stop my presentation.
Thank you, Reşat. Thank you very much. Okay, our next speaker would be Manas. Manas, you have your 10 minutes to share your very elaborate PowerPoint. Please.
Okay. Thank you very much for inviting me. I am sharing my PowerPoint now. Okay, yes. Yes, this is the title of my presentation is the Potentialities of Peace Science and Regional Science in the Disaster Management Research with special reference to COVID-19. And peace science and regional science, this is very new social science discipline. I worked with Walter Isert for many years ago, for the last about 30 years, 40 years of the development of regional science and peace science. In regional science, most important thing is a space, geographical space, and then that's the most important thing. And in the case of peace science, most important thing is conflict management between different areas. In the case of that, there are many regional science methods and techniques have been developed over the last 30, 40 years. But what I'm trying to do, I am going to get this question of space, geographical space as something related to COVID-19 and other disaster management. I'm interested not only on COVID-19, I'm interested, I've worked on the Nepal disaster, tsunami in Japan and many other places. So the whole idea is to use the geographical space as a prime variable in explaining and get the interrelationship between different factors. And then in that process, there will be a lot of conflict in geographical space, how to use the peace science techniques which you have developed for the last 30, 40 years, the coordination, cooperation, and of peace science techniques in that. And then I have tried to integrate this area of epidemiology and international relations as a part of regional science, peace science, management science together to come out a more viable theoretical analysis. I do not have time more than 10 minutes. I know I'll finish before that. But if you're interested to have more information, you can get in touch with me. My name is Professor Chatterji, Manas Chatterji. I have come to books coming on globalization and conflict and also international migration and conflict from Graduate School of International Studies in Geneva. And also we are organizing a major meeting on the a major meeting on COVID-19 in Binghamton, State University of New York at Binghamton, with many, many famous work scholars, expanding with many other things. In the case of most important thing is this interregional input-output bundle. This is the same thing which I want to use in the case of, you know, multiplier effect between the people who are getting sick from COVID-19. The multiplier effect is the most important thing which have been used in regional science between different regions, regional table, dynamic tables, and so on and so forth. And also the question of econometrics, regional econometrics, spatial econometrics, econometrics over space. So what I'm saying that this regional econometrics input-output models can be changed to use in the area of disaster management. That's the type of thing I'm going to do. Also the question of gravity models, attraction between two two items in the space, which have been used in gravity models in international migration, which is the number one thing in COVID-19, how we have used the gravity models in COVID-19. And so this, recently we have the big data science and artificial intelligence, and also the urban systems. These are the things, behavioral geography, for example, how people behave in space because of COVID-19. So what I'm trying to do, I'm trying to find out some new theory, new platform to in which we can put this together and use this some kind of econometric models or input-output models to predict the situation in the future. Not only that, and what is this implication of this for the international relations? Then this question of another thing I'm working with other people in global warming, the environment and health in developing countries particularly. How environment is a factor. So far, regional science and peace science, the environment has not been taken into consideration in the whole system. I'm combining the environmental things, global warming, and this type of thing, and also the question of psychology, and big data science, and artificial intelligence, and then these are the different things. But if you're interested in to more, you can Walter Isaac's books, you can see, and also my book on environment and health in the developing countries, which have discussed this question of spatial epidemiology and how you have combined with other places. Now this, in peace, many of you already know, in peace science, we have discussed the question of game theory. The whole area of COVID-19 is a game between different types of people, different United States, different countries, China and United States. So applying the question of game theory, and this cognitive science, negotiation with the WHO or other places, and arbitration, coalition theories, coalition between the European countries, EU and United States versus China and so on and so forth, and negotiation, arbitration. All these things together, I'm trying to put this together to have a new theory of geographical space and also the negotiation and conflict management, and these type of things I've discussed in my institute, Mahatma Gandhi Center in Conflict Prevention and Management in Bangalore for the last 10 years. These are the things I have discussed there before. And I'm organizing a major meeting on conflict and peace in South Asia. So the one thing I just do at this stage is the question of spatial inequality, you know, horizontal inequality. What is the problem of people who are poor, who are lower caste people? How the climate, how this question of COVID-19 affecting them? You know, it's a disaster and the type of people. This is a humanitarian disaster management. Then we have to find out not to minimize costs to control the disaster, but also to find out to maximize the humanitarian aspect of that. These are the things I'm discussing in my books, which have been coming out in two volumes from Graduate School of International Studies. And these are there are many other things here, but one thing I just want to mention here, because I'm getting, man-made disaster and man-made disaster combined with natural disaster. You know, this how combined this terrorism, global warming, environmental, chemical disaster, you know, at like Bhopal many years ago. How I can come up with some kind of a theoretical models or putting this together. This is really a big task. I don't know if I can do myself, but many people are working in this area. And then a question of problem with globalization. My book on globalization coming up discuss how globalization and question of epidemiology and question of COVID-19, how is affecting the globalization between different countries. And then this there are these spatial inequality, conflict, economic growth and conflict management, development and theory, inequality and conflict in Africa, for example, all these together, is a theoretical basis of that. This is the thing I'm working on. I'm a statistician, I'm a mathematical statistician. I'm trying to put this together and then somehow estimate the parameters of this equation by different techniques of econometrics and advanced theory of artificial intelligence. And then this question of, data for that. And then social factor, this is the data for Catholic peace science, as you know, is a vast thing we've developed for the last 50 years. Great amount of work has been done in peace science. I'm one of the architects with Walter Isert, the Peace Science Society International. We established this about 50 years ago, and regional science about 60 years ago, and they are doing very, very well. But this new thing of disaster, new thing of epidemiology, new thing of international relations in regional science, peace science is something I am promoting at this time, and I hope younger people will do good things in the future. And then And then another thing, which is I'm very interested, I told you before, I'm working in the area of COVID-19, is the epidemiological model of COVID-19. You know, the standard SAR model, which is used by different people in the United States. You'll be surprised to see how these people in different universities in the United States and also in South Africa, they're using this model, the Poisson model and mathematical model of normal distribution, Gaussian distribution, and how they're using this model to find out the infection rates of different people in different areas of the countries, how it's spreading to different countries. A fantastic thing they're doing in the case of, the standard SAR model. And next, here, you see, this is the main thing, main three equations.
You have now 10 minutes. Take two more minutes. You still have about 10 slides. You will not get the 10 slides. The most important ones.
Okay, I take 2 minutes. Okay, yes. This is the thing that they are using in estimating the infection rate of different types of people in different geographical areas and people with metropolitan areas and suburb areas and so on and so forth. And these are the, in the future, if somebody wants to have some information about who are the people working in this area, you can get in touch with me so I can supply the information about the different types of model, spatial, epidemiological, and conflict management, and also cooperation between different groups of people in public policy. These are the fantastic things coming up in the future. I don't know, in Europe also some people are doing, I have done something in Rome and also in Brussels and also in Geneva, but in India, some, not so many, but some people are doing, South Africa and United States are doing, also in Israel also. Some people are doing the Israel cases, they have done this before. Okay, thank you very much for the also question of mental health, environmental science, technology and innovation. See, that's a very important thing also. I'm trying to have the technologies, society and conflict and combine this with whole area. It's a big stress thing. I don't think I can finish this in the future, but I'm just asking, other people, in the area of regional science and peace science to develop this type of thing work in the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Manas, for the impossible effort to bring all this enormous stuff in 10 minutes and 26 slides. So last but not least, we'll turn to TV Paul, and TV will tell us about realism, liberalism, regional orders in East Asia towards an hybrid approach. And the hybrid approach, as I mentioned, has nothing to do with our teaching in the last 2 years.
Thank you, Harry, for connecting with the interesting group of people who are doing a lot of work in this area. I'm actually presenting a paper that's coming out potentially in a journal special issue edited by Bhubinder Singh at RSIS Singapore. So he asked me to write about how IR theory should address regional transformations. Original order. And so I thought I will try to do a bit conventional, but at the same time questioning some of the approaches that are dominant in both realism and liberalism, and the kind of inconsistencies that we often ignore in these perspectives. So this actually is another project of the Global Research Network on Peaceful Change that Arie is the regional coordinator for the Middle East. And we have a handbook, OUP handbook. We have a international affairs special issue, ethics and international affairs special issue. And currently two other special issues are considered and potentially a few more projects. So some of you may be interested to connect with us. We have ideas for some future programs and projects. In any case, I'm looking at two of the dominant perspectives, realism, liberalism, to explain regional order transition, especially the peaceful variety, and apply some of their insights into East Asia region. And East Asia region, or Northeast Asia, basically, can best be conceptualized as a hybrid order characterized by cold peace in much of the region, except the Korean Peninsula and Taiwan, China area, where it is more like a Cold War. Well, Southeast Asia, you can find a normal peace, but yet not a warm or deep peace. I'm actually using a lot of this concept from Benny Miller, and to some extent, Arie developed this some early on. So Benny should be quite happy that I am overly citing him, but it is good that Benny's models needs to be recognized a bit more. So I go into discussing different types of regional orders, different types of peace that Benny himself and others have articulated. I won't go into detail because I'm sure most of you know about it. But then I discuss a bit of the notion of peaceful change as developed in the handbook, as a continuum along minimalist and maximalist spectrum, from cold peace or regular peace to warm peace. So I think these spectrums are useful to see whether our dominant theoretical paradigms can address, explain these spectrums in different fashions. The realist mechanisms, as you know, are dominant mechanisms of order and stability, no peace, no perpetual peace. In realism, as we know, the conflict is so endemic. Balance of power, basically, that peace and security are possible. To some extent, not the peace, but stability is possible. and that often structural realists in particular pay a lot of attention to the great powers, as it was presented by Reşat, you know, importance of great powers in that system. And the big unanswered question is whether the regional balancing can occur independently of global balancing among great powers. So I think the structural realists put a lot of importance to system level balancing, with often ignoring the level of balancing in regions. And stability is probably what we're talking about, and Cold War or Cold Peace are, as a no war outcome is most feasible in an anarchic system. Then there is the second strand of scholarship based on hegemonic stability. Again, Gilpin is coming here. Actually, it's a big contradiction here. How can balancing is based on a notion that peace is preserved when there is equilibrium, nobody predominates, whereas in hegemonic stability, somebody has to predominate. The dominant power provides collective goods as peace. I think these are two contradictory strands of realism, often not recognized sufficiently. We just repeat them as if they are not contradictory. They are contradictory, in my view. In the East Asia region, we find partial support for both perspectives due to different historical eras. So in the Cold War, of course, you have the intense balance of power. But there are a lot of anomalies and puzzles. The conflicts, Korean War was initiated by a weaker North Korea. And initially, and the support of China and Russia, Chinese intervention in Korea offers a major challenge to balance of power theory. Vietnam invaded Cambodia in 1975, despite receiving Chinese, US, and ASEAN support. And the way Southeast Asian countries formed the ASEAN grouping, et cetera. So balance of power is probably relevant in the enduring rivalries of the zone, but you don't find that much in the other sub parts of the region. Hegemonic stability, again, based on American dominance, you find that a lot of challenges to that aspect too. In fact, much of the cooperation that's taking place now in the economic arena, whether it is APEC, whether it is CPTP, RCEP, all US is not even part of it. APEC, yes, but the initiatives are coming from the secondary states. So there is a liberal bias to hegemonic stability theory. And the notion is that somehow only if a liberal state is in dominance, peace will preserve. And we only just witnessed the malevolent side of American hegemony coming out of Mr. Trump's period. And I don't think the American hegemony is going to persist the way it is going to. So the Chinese have a notion of Tianxia, as we all know. And not that I'm a big fan of the Chinese model, but logically, there's nothing that could prevent the hegemonic peace if China dominates the world or East Asia. But the question is, somehow liberals think that only when liberals are in charge, things will happen. So that's where I go into, and I had only a couple of minutes, regional order, looking at the liberal perspectives. And I think this is where a big problem, because much of East Asia is not liberal, democratic. They have the two of the components. Actually, one and a half, I call it. The first component is economic interdependence, yes, big way, and a half institutionalized region, but not much democracy. And in fact, so the kind of peace or the stability you witness going by the liberal model, it is never going to get to that warm peace, deep peace, if we need European style, the triad, all the three elements of the Kantian tripod. So, that's where I think it's impossible. Maybe there is a way, that is to think of a realist-liberal hybrid approach. Now, imagine I'm not looking at all other perspectives. The paper was supposed to be a shorter one, so I only focus on this. I know there is a lot of other literature out there, English school, constructivism, and all, critical theory. So I think this is already proposed in some works like Rosemary Foote, or Barry Buzan, et cetera. I think there is a great power role that we need to look at a little bit more closely what exactly the great powers do. And I think Reşat did touch on the subject. The problem that I have with the great power piece is great powers can be a big source of violence in the international system, as we all know. Structural variety, that's the Johann Galtung's notion. And yet we don't really address that properly in our literature. There is a great power bias to IR, of course. We all live in great powers and we need to support what they're doing often. Without critically analyzing the problems that great powers cause, often unnecessary violence and disturbances to regional orders. So liberal mechanisms are also affected by material changes, distribution of power. Liberal institutions can be affected similarly. And so realist insights on power relations are useful for understanding the initial phase of regional orders after pivotal events similar to World War or end of the Cold War, when opportunities emerge for second-ranking states to engage, balance, or bandwagon with great powers. If the great power relations are intensely conflictual, weaker states will find it hard to form independent foreign policies. This does not mean that they cannot try doing so, as newly emerging Asian and African states attempted through the non-aligned mechanism. ASEAN states made similarly efforts. So at pre-existing territorial identity conflicts are frequently resurface as inhibitors to full-blown warm peace emerging. Interdependence in some interstate contexts prevent escalation of limited conflict crisis, but cannot remove the root causes of the conflict. However, if actors are willing to give certain level institutional architecture to the relations, they can help mitigate escalation dynamics. So what you notice is potentially a limited hegemony is emerging in the East Asia region, but that may not reflect any of the typical IR perspective, but maybe a combination of some of them, and it may undergo changes as time passes. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, TV. Okay, so now it's our turn. So Galia, please enlighten us with your comments.
Okay, we had five interesting, some of them very different papers, and I will try to say something about each paper. I will do my best. So I think I will just go by the order of the presentations. Starting with Rami's paper, I guess I have one comment and one question, trying to somehow, I guess, translate this really interesting big model into existing work in international relations. The comment I had was just about your initial comment when you started, and you said that coming from a refugee experience lead you to think of why is there no world peace. And I actually thought that was such an optimistic sort of way of looking at life, because I could think of the opposite conclusion, that if you come from a violent, a background of experiencing conflict, you're to begin with very skeptical about the ability to reach world peace. So this is very admirable how you start with a very positive approach. I'm not sure I completely understood the whole model. I know it was, a lot to say in 10 minutes, but I guess my question here is whether, when you're talking about the Western Empire, which is, as you said, not just Western states, but the idea of the West or the EU, how different is this from existing discussions about the liberal international order and the members of that international order that are there, through international institutions and shared norms and all that stuff? So, I mean, the idea of the Western Empire sounded to me a bit like the liberal international order, and I wonder if you can sort of explain what the difference is there. And you were talking about constitutional patriotism as an important, mechanism in the process of moving all the way to this fusion into this one first world. That reminded me of earlier discussions today that Benny Miller, that is keeps being mentioned here, talked about the rise of ethnic nationalism as something that is actually very troubling for the liberal international order. And the flip side of this is the idea of civic nationalism that allows citizens to participate in a state, to participate in international institutions because of the civic dimension that sort of holds them together and allows that fusion. So I'm wondering how similar that is, this constitutional patriotism, which is just a concept I myself am not familiar with, and civic nationalism. So this is very inspiring, and I would like to understand how this connects to existing work in IR. So thank you. Next was Raquel. I guess my question is about the part that you actually didn't present here. There it seems in the paper itself, there are like three different parts that somehow need to be connected or rearranged, because it wasn't completely clear to me what the topic of the paper is. There's the part where you discuss, you know, Waltz and Wallerstein and the different approaches to dependence. And the world system and the international system. But everything supposedly is framed around the decision-making models, which you never really get to in the version of the paper that we've read. And then there's the case study of the missile technology control regime, which I'm not sure how it is connected. So I think I would be very happy if you can clarify at least where this paper is going. Is this a paper about the regime, the missile technology control regime restrictions, as it is seen through the semi-periphery and reflecting the special situation of the semi-periphery between periphery and the core? It's not the three parts. I'm not sure how they are connected. Just like a really small thing, you cite a lot Waltz, Man, State, and War as like 2004. So, you know, maybe it's better to write 1959 just because, you know, it's really old work that you know, you're citing. And I think there's a lot of work that has come after that. So if you could just clarify what the actual next stage of the paper is, that will be very helpful for me. Right. Okay. Sorry, I lost my notes. Okay. Reşat, I have more comments here. I'll try to just say a few and then send you the rest of them. I guess the main thing I want to say is that I think the presentation was much clearer than the paper in terms of the structure, because in the paper there's like so much stuff going on there. And there are basically, as you present in the PowerPoint, there are two main independent variables about how great powers can actually influence minor power peaceful relations or peace upgrading, okay? And in the presentation, it's very clear. And in the paper, by the time you get to this at a later stage, I think you can rearrange the paper a bit so that in the theoretical section, you really discuss more deeply just these two variables and what do you mean, for example, by these global universalistic norms. It's never fully clear to me, at least in the paper, if you're talking about systemic norms or if you're just talking about the conflict and cooperation between the great powers. So that would be very helpful for me. I'll skip a lot of this other stuff. I'm wondering if okay, you also cite Benny Miller's work, and I think it might be useful for you also to look at his older book on When Opponents Cooperate, and not the newer book, which, you know, builds on it, but it's When Opponents Cooperate actually directly deals with this impact of the nature of great power relationship on regional peace. So I think it's worthwhile looking at that older book because it resonates a lot of the things that you're saying. And you do say at the beginning that there's very little stuff that's actually written on this. And I think that's like, that to me stood out as an important thing to look at. I'll skip because I have three more papers. I guess the one question I had about the alliance, the correlation between, you know, alliance with great powers and peace upgrading is very curious and sort of, I like alliances, so it's interesting. I wonder if you, in the data, can tell whether the regional states you're looking at are the ones that are in a transition to peace, to a certain level of peace, if both of them need to be allied with a great power, are they allied with the same great power or with different great powers? It seems like, you know, it is extremely relevant, but you need to know who the great powers are, they are aligning with, okay? So I'm not sure if this is actually something that comes out in the data, and I'll just send you the rest of my comments, so it won't take so much time. Okay, and Manas, this was very impressive in terms of like, you know, okay, there's so much stuff you can do, and I never heard before about regional science, so thank you, because it's because I went to look to see what is regional science. And I guess my question or my plea to you is that if you want to, I mean, there are like hundreds of research projects, thousands of research projects in the presentation that you've made, but if you really want to, you know, to create a dialogue with international relations scholars, I think it's really important to try to flesh out the political implications of these different insights that you mentioned, and especially this whole issue of the importance of space and spatial configurations on, for example, the politics of crisis of, you know, of disaster management in the context of COVID. So I was looking at all the different slides and none of that takes the next step to say, okay, what are the political implications of this? So if you can take just one of them, you know, and illustrate it here, that would be very helpful to me, for me to understand where, you know, how you can use this to actually improve our understanding of international political relationships. So this is very interesting. Thank you. And last but not least, TV. I have three quick comments. One, the whole idea of the hybrid model, isn't this a bit, you know, the idea of like Peter Katzenstein's analytical eclecticism, you know, that you, if you actually want to understand the region and not necessarily advance the theory, then of course you need to use a combination of theories, because you didn't use that concept, and I was wondering if that's actually what you mean. The second thing, you know, I read the paper and, you know, I thought about the theories, and I think the next step would be, if we're talking again about regional transformations and again this peaceful change, each theoretical model explains to you what happens in a given regional moment, okay? How the institutions work, what is the balance of power? And I'm wondering, I think maybe we need to focus more on the mechanisms of change that each theory offers, but really just to push more just the issue of change rather than, you know, talking about what hegemonic system looks like, for example. Because the key there for me, the interesting thing is how change occurs, and discussing the different theoretical approaches usually ends up talking about given orders and how they operate, and not so much about how transformation would come about, and would it necessarily not be peaceful, or, you know, whatever. So that's one, the second comment, and the third and my last comment, has to do with, again, when we're talking about regional transformations and peaceful change, I think the issue of path dependency in regional development is really important and perhaps worth greater exploration, because especially when you look at the, you know, regional institutional arrangements in East Asia, for example, you look at the regional security architecture in the 2000s up to today, a lot of it is completely sort of path dependent on post-World War II arrangements that the U.S. has generated there. So I think another avenue for research is to actually focus on the path dependent development of, you know, through the different theories, you know, what happens when you move from a hegemonic system to a balance of power system? What are the leftover sort of remnants of bipolarity or multipolarity and so on? You know, the institutional structure, what in time T1 to T2 to T3, how that influences where the region is going, focusing on path dependency is interesting. So I think this was very, this was okay. This was pretty fast. Arie, I did it fast enough?
No, that's perfect. That's fine. Okay.
Thank you, but thank you very much. These are all interesting papers and I enjoyed reading them.
Okay.
Thank you.
Let me suggest a few comments and then we'll open for questions from the audience. So the first thing I want to do, this is something that I didn't plan ahead, but listening to the five papers, trying to put that together, because actually Galia and myself, we try to, you know, make the papers into panels. So all the five papers have something to do with the theoretical contributions to peace science. What is interesting is some of you, you engage in your own theoretical thinking. Some of you are trying more to engage with existing theories like Raquel or TB and trying to implement that. There are also motifs that are recurrent, like empire, dependency, hegemony. I remember Raquel that this is attribute to Cardoso, that dependency, you don't want to call it imperialism, so you use dependency to get the grants from MacArthur, something like that, okay? But in a sense, there is a strong relationship. And another third motive is that most or all of the papers have to do with uncertainty and transitions into this new world order. There are some interesting dialogues, to some extent, Reşat and TV, you address similar problems. So let me, as Galia did, maybe offer specific comments very, very quickly to each of you. So Rami, I think you again, engage in modeling. I mean, it's not easy to try to understand the, and it's not because we don't understand your English. Your English is very clear, but yes. What are those five models? Which fusion are you talking about? I have also a general comment to you in comparison to a TV is that, okay, so we have, it's not the first, second, and third world, but it's rather it's more complicated than that, right? Now
can Larissa help me with translation, because I think it's the best for me to.
Okay, but you're answering that. I mean, you have this geographical distribution. And a second point would be that if you talk about empire, whether you refer to empire, because empire usually means there is no international relations like the Roman Empire or the British Empire. I don't think you mean that here, right? So maybe you mean something different. And the last question I want to address is that what then is your diagnosis, or what you suggest are you suggesting a world federation, a galactic empire? I'm serious. I mean, what that's what you have in mind?
This is very simple idea, but I need now to speak to German. Maybe can Larissa help me, please?
Larissa will help you.
I want to see only one point. The question is not what the world order will be like in this century.
Okay. If Larissa, you can help sending in German to right? So and we come back to that. Yes. Okay. So let me move to Raquel, and if you can stop the share so we can see each other, you know. Can you stop the share?
My share?
Yes, you.
Sorry.
That's perfectly fine. You know, I'm used to see people because when you are lost in a PowerPoint, so you lost the eye contact with the yellow squares. So Raquel, actually, Galia ask you the same comments. I mean, that in a sense, and we read your paper, and there are several ideas going on, right? I mean, I, like you, like Cardoso and Faletto, I recommend to everybody here. I think it's one of the greatest books, right? It's much, their theory on dependency, I think it's much more sophisticated than the modern world system or Gunter Frank, or, right? I mean, it's much more sophisticated. So you seem to like that as well. The question is whether you want to apply that. Because in the paper, and not in your presentation, I think in the paper you have this interesting idea about this regime of missile technology. And I think I mentioned that to you, that there are two books of two great scholars. I think that was for each of them their first book, their dissertation. One is Emmanuel Adler. And Emmanuel Adler wrote about the technology, comparing Brazil and Argentina. And the second author was Catherine Seeking. And Catherine Seeking, that they both wrote about Latin America autonomy and development. So, because it was not clear to me I guess this is part of your dissertation, but we can continue the dialogue. To Reşat, and I'm glad that you get rid of this concept of frozen peace, right? That you had because it's really unclear. And if you talk about peace, and this is, I have an argument for the last 30 years with Benny Miller, right? The Cold War has nothing to do with peace, right? Peace for me starts with negative peace. You can call it a cold peace or precarious peace, whatever, right? But I think what you have there, I mean, you have many interesting things going on in your paper. It's the idea, and in that sense, I think it's publishable, although again, it's very baroque, it's very, you know, dense, your paper, but this idea, and that's what I'm putting together your paper with TV, that to some extent, great powers that they might ally with minor powers, that might have a positive effect about the peace among minor powers, right? And I always want to think in empirical terms, and what I had in mind is, for instance, the US mediating the Israeli-Egyptian peace. Although the initiative was not by the US, the US came as a babysitter, the initiative was from Sadat, right? But that might, in a sense, illustrate that. And I think that one thing that it's missing there, it's the theoretical or commonsensical, because I always say theory is mostly common sense, that I would make the argument, although maybe you wrote that, and I think it's very important that alliances can offer reassurance, right? And reduce the security dilemma. So in that sense, that might allow the minor powers to move in the direction of peace. Okay, Manas, as Galia said, this is very, very impressive. although it's not a paper. I mean, does not look like a paper. It looks like an agenda for further research, right? And my pointed question to you would be, whether can we consider COVID-19 as a disaster? I mean, we know it's a disaster, right? I mean, we are living with that for the last 2 years, but is this like an earthquake or a man-made? I don't know whether it's man-made, whether it's Chinese-made or bat-made, I don't know, right? But whether COVID, it's like a disaster. That's a pointed question. And last but not least, to TV, and I think I send you TV a written comments, right? One thing that I want to share with the panel here, and this is something, I mean, it's funny, you know, it's typical Israeli chutzpah. Chutzpah is an Hebrew name, right? You are the expert on that region. But I remember when I teach peace in IR, that there is this, I don't remember the journal about East Asia, they have a special issue about explaining the East Asian peace. And what you did not mention, and again, it might be related to liberalism, I don't know, it's the idea of development peace. It has nothing to do with democracy, okay? Because what you suggest, it makes a lot of sense. Again, you know, I never wrote about this, the East Peace, but when I compare zones of peace, so I have a couple of pages. So there I you could say, okay, you have, as you say, hegemony and balance of power to explain the East Asian or Northeast Asian peace. Southeast Asia, ASEAN, I think it's a different story. And I think that some other scholars would dispute, might say ASEAN might be an emergent pluralistic security community, and a security community, it's a liberal argument, right? So by the end of the day, as you say, since I'm a Groshen, or, you know, so hybrid fits very well, right? Because you take from realism and from liberalism to explain the East Asian peace. Okay, so we still have about 13 minutes. I mean, we don't have to end, we are supposed to end a quarter to 10, because on a personal level, I need a little break to continue with my South American colleagues, right, for the last session. But let's open first if there are comments. Larissa, thank you so much that you are helping in with this.
Maybe could you, Arie, summarize your question to Rami again, just for me to translate it better.
Okay, I can write that to everybody, right? I mean, what is the solution, right? And whether it's the other question is like what Galia ask. Okay, so we don't have to start with Rami until, I mean, but before, I mean, there might be we don't have much of an audience, but we have a very small quality audience. So any questions that you want to raise to our panelists before we give the floor back to them? And TV, if you have a question, not about you, but about somebody else.
Yeah, actually about somebody, actually to the paper on, let me just see, Reşat's paper, yeah. My concern about this great power and the regional states piece, I think we are still, we are picking cases that fit in. I mean, Israel, Arab, and Egyptian peace, yes, but there's a long history of great powers meddling and supporting, and then smaller states starting wars, Egypt included, expecting great power support. In fact, my dissertation turned book, Asymmetric Conflicts, War Initiation by Weaker Powers, one of the big variables is expected great power support from weaker powers that led them to start wars. And if you look at all the regions where wars took place, India, Pakistan included, Pakistan expected great power support, China, US, Egypt expected great power support. And all the cases, even Argentina, expected American support in the Falklands. So in the Cold War, many of the wars were caused by this great power proxy competition, expectations in the weaker parties that they will be supported. And you notice that after the end of the Cold War, that expectation diminished for a period of time. And you don't have many wars, I guess, part of it, maybe other causes too. But the other thing I want to say is, in the previous plenary section, we talked about this great power interventions. You know, American interventions are the main reason for what Middle East is today in terms of the total lack of progress and violence and all that. And there's a tendency to ignore these interventions derived by, often by these great power leaders for status reasons. Brezhnev going into Afghanistan, US going after Saddam Hussein, try to show that they are, you know, they are the top dogs, often by a small bunch of men sitting in decision-making role. So my contention is this idea that great powers are peace creators, a very big problematic. By picking a few cases of peace generation, it's not sufficient to show their perennial problematic history for the past more than 200 years. If you go back to Treaty of Westphalia onwards, the kind of violence they cause, structural included, before we give them too much pass. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, TB. Anybody else? Questions, comments? Manas, not about you, but about somebody else. We cannot hear you, Manas.
Okay, you can hear me now, right?
Yes.
Yeah, but I just want to say the two things. I was very impressed by the organization of the meeting. You know, I have organized many meetings in the past. The way you are doing the whole thing is very, very good. You know, I really like it. But one second thing I want to say, that although I liked all the papers, I, as a statistician, as a mathematician, you know, I just wanted to have some data analysis, you know, and the question of information, data analytics. These are the things which are really becoming absent in the International Studies Association papers, which I attend. But the people who are really working in the peace science area, they had this excellent data situation. If you will be surprised how they have done that in the journal like Peace Science and Conflict Management, which I used to edit, and also the Scandinavian Journal of Peace Science. The data analysis, analytical things, you know, models, and the application of different techniques which are coming up in management science, that type of thing are really still absent in the International Studies Association meetings. That's why we have some joint session with Peace Science Society, 4 or 5 joint session with ISET on historical basis to fill up the gap, what they are doing and what we are doing in the case of peace science. And I think in the future, if we look at the published in the International Studies Association journal, most of the articles in that journals are very, very data oriented and theoretically oriented, rather than more descriptive type of things which we have discussed in this particular seminar. So we need to do together, you know, the question of statistical things, mathematical things, artificial intelligence, all that type of thing, and actual practical things which people have done excellently in this particular session. I really enjoyed all of them, although I'm not very proficient on many of those type of topics, but this is very, very enjoyable meeting for me, and I enjoyed them all. Thank you.
Thank you. Again, it's a question of supply and demand. I mean, we didn't get many mathematical papers, right? So, Henrik, a question to the point. Yes, please.
Thank you, Ari. I have 4 very brief points I will rush through. The first one is for the German colleague from Vechta, whose name I did not understand.
Rami.
As far as I understood, he offers five models of world systems. Now, I missed the first 5 minutes, so I do not know which the first one was. But as far as I remember, he did not refer to the world system analysis of late Immanuel Wallerstein. Why? I think if you use the term world system, you cannot do that without Wallerstein. Second point, gratefully, the next speaker, Raquel, included him, and I thank you for that. My third point is to Manas. In your agenda or list of most relevant topics in IR, peace research for the future, I missed one gravitational issue, forcibly displaced persons and mass migration. Why? That is the topic I work on, but I mean, we are confronted with that every day, especially here. I am based in Istanbul, and it is a horrible problem. Last point, I don't know who that was, the lady. You mentioned the importance of path dependency. I work, among other things, on evolutionary science. And in evolutionary science, path dependency is one of the most crucial explanatory terms. I would like you, or anyone, to try to connect the path dependency with a completely untouched question of why we talk about peaceful change. The other possibility mentioned was stagnation, but there is a third one as well, and that is the relapse, the fallback. And we experience that many, many, many times. For instance, why was the peaceful change in South Sudan? It fall back. We have the same in Congo. We have the same, well, in, you know, the cases. So how would you explain these fallbacks, which are, I think, maybe one of the most important topics in peace research, because we have to work on how to prevent such relapses. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for being a fair discussant. So what should we do? I mean, I'm completely exhausted. So does anybody of the participants, do you want to take, because it has to be 1 minute or even less?
I just wanted to do on Hendrik one point. We had a big meeting in Graduate School of International Studies in Geneva on international migration. And I'm editing a book which is coming out very soon on the question of international migration and development, considering migration to Europe, migration from, you know, all these things are coming up, which I didn't mention. But we are using what is known as the gravity models, maybe you know.
Okay. Okay, let's get 1 minute to each of you. By the way, Hendrik, I think that Hendrik and Manas, you can keep talking for ages, the two of you, right? But it's outside. So let's do the other way around. We'll start with you, TV. Just take
I think Hendrik raised a very important point, that is, all our studies on peaceful change somehow assume there's a linear progression. Right. And these ups and downs and sometimes total retrenchment. And I, in the plenary session, I mentioned the problem of great powers themselves.
Exactly.
You have a Gorbachev with such ideas of transformation. And then now look what the other guy, Putin, is doing today. And then you have China, you know, peaceful rise, one of the very rare great powers ever thought about this as a strategic option. Now that retrenchment taking place under Xi Jinping, although he claims he's not abandoning it completely.
Yeah.
And the United States, I mean, transforming into something that is very, very worrisome, this sort of a liberal hegemon into a chaotic hegemon over a period of domestic coalitions, etc. So I think a super topic to think about, both at the international level, regional level, domestic level, and you will see that this is a topic that hasn't been studied well. I mean, peace building people have some literature on it, by the way, not peacekeeping, peace building. How do peace building can take place and how do they fail over a period of time? But in this scholarship that we are talking about, this should be a focus later on or sooner than later. Thank you.
Thank you.
Wait.
Reşat.
So let me very quickly just show something from the that could maybe help to clarify what I'm also doing here. So notice that in this sort of longer table, I actually also analyze not only from a very low level of peace, so also at a low level of peace going back to war. So I'm actually not just interested in the idea of whether these sorts of entities reach higher levels of peace, but how some of these same international, same factors can also be involved in actually taking these guys also to warfare, basically. In other words, some of the same factors we use for explaining peace in this case, can they be used for explaining warfare, vice versa? And what you end up seeing in some of the variables that I'm using here is, in fact, yes, that major powers, of course, are playing a negative role in the sense, in the sort of stuff that you're saying, but it's actually not just one way. Yes, some of the factors that you're considering bring us to warfare in these major power alignments, but we are also finding in the sort of 200 years of data that I am presenting in that sort of table there, which is not just post-World War II, but 19th century, not just Europe, but also Africa, Asia, etc., that there are other things going there as well. But yeah, so it's multiple things have to be brought into consideration, but I know that I did not present that a couple of minutes ago. But yeah, thanks for giving me the time to go over that.
Okay, thank you, Reşat. Manas,
yes, just one thing. I think all the papers are very, very good. One thing we did not cover is the question of the arms spending by the particularly rich countries, arms spending, military spending, you know, not only, and also the question of nuclear competition between different countries. These are the two basic things which we covered in a very big meeting in Barcelona. Last month or two months ago, 2,500 people were attended and questioning the arms spending and reduce arms spending and use the money for the people who are suffering
in different
countries. This we did not cover in this particular session, particular meeting here.
Right.
Okay. Thank you. You are coherent because you mentioned the same. It's really a problem that concerns you because you made the same comment in the plenary session.
Right.
Okay, Raquel, your turn.
Thank you. Thank you for the comments. In my paper, it's a part of my research for my dissertation. And in that, I try to understand what structure and the systemic constraints semi-periphery states face when cooperating critical areas. In this case, I try to make a research, not a case study, an analysis of the decision-making process that led Brazil and Ukraine to cooperate and to break this cooperation in the space sector. It is this work that I present. I try to think about some aspects that it's important to consider when this same or approximate kind of countries try to break the regimes. Thank you for the comments and thank you.
Okay. I have the chair of the next session getting in, so that this is a kind of indication. Rami, you have the last word. It's yes, between you and the South America regional order.
Okay. Can Larissa cast me sure? Larissa?
Ja, alles
gut. Kannst du bitte kurz zuerst die Frage von Galia, also warum das ist so optimistisch? Ja? Mhm. Also die Frage ist nicht, wie die Weltordnung im 21. Jahrhundert aussehen wird, sondern ob unsere demokratischen Werte dieses Jahrhundert überleben werden. Das ist die Frage. So. Und dieser Optimismus hier, weil hier wir haben eine Fusion, ist keine Allianz. Bei der Fusion der Weltmächte und anderer demokratischer Staaten muss nicht westlich alle demokratischen Staaten. Bei dieser Fusion ist diese Verschmelzung der Mächte, ökonomischer Mächte und geopolitische Mächte. Das heißt, wir haben eine Maximierung der Macht. Ökonomisch, Maximierung der Macht, militärisch. Gleich Abschreckungstheorie. Und so kann man den Frieden sichern. Also nochmal, Abschreckungstheorie kommt durch die Maximierung der Macht, politischer Macht und ökonomischer Macht. So. Und das ist optimistisch, ja, weil die Maximierung dieser beiden Mächte ökonomisch und dann haben wir gesichert den Frieden, weil es gibt kein anderes Gebilde, die das westliche Imperium bedroht. Das ist okay. Realismus.
Larissa, do you want to translate? I feel like we are at the UN and that would be the last sentence before we close the session, since we have the next session coming very soon. Larissa, yeah. You have the last words.
Okay, so the answer was that this is more about a fusion and not an alliance. And this fusion of the world powers and other democratic states, which don't have to be Western states, but democratic, they kind of, yeah, this fusion is about economic powers and military powers. And with this maximization of powers, the kind of deterrence mechanism comes into force. And that is how the world order or the peace can be controlled.
Okay.
Und dann sollte ich noch weiter.
Ich glaube, es ist keine Zeit mehr dafür.
Ach so, okay.
Yeah.
Maybe Galia, I send you later the answer.
Okay. So anyway, on that very international note, I want to thank all the participants and I want to thank Galia. So I wish you all the best. And if you want to stay, we still have the last session from that will start in a few minutes, that will take us into South America. I want to correct you, TB, you made a mistake when you say Argentina was asking for support. It's not from America, it's from the USA. It's USA and you are from Canada. You have to know that better than me. Okay, so on that note, I wish you all the best. Thank you, Galia, for co-hosting this session on the conference. So you leave, I stay with Camila and our Brazilian colleagues. Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.